Yes, so if you can already take seats, yes. My name's Adam. I'm an elder in training here at Beacon Church, and this is time where we do our responsive reading. It's a weekly practice we have here, where we together as a body in Christ confess that faith that unites us in Christ. We also like to spend a little bit of time, a brief time here teaching before we do this reading, just to encourage you in a Berean habit of searching the scriptures to see whether these things are so, and hopefully to encourage you in that habit, as well as to, so that you know not only what we believe as Christians, but why. And this week then, our question is actually two questions. What does justification mean, and what does sanctification mean? And in the context of salvation, these are both profound doctrines. For instance, Michael Horton, a well-known theologian, he's published a 900-plus-page, two-volume set just on the doctrine of justification alone. I'm not here to put you to sleep, though. I plan to just stick to the essential elements of these doctrines, but remembering that I'm not discussing the whole of these things, these are things I encourage you, if you haven't already, to remember. So with that said, in the context of salvation, what does justification mean? Really at its heart, justification is about God rendering judgment upon someone where he declares them righteous in his sight. So in Romans chapter 4, Romans is a letter that Paul wrote to the church in Rome, and it lays a lot of the groundwork for the basics of the Christian faith. And surprisingly, he lays out a lot about both justification and sanctification there. That's what I'm looking there. And in chapter 4 of Romans, he actually looks back to Genesis chapter 15, where God is establishing his covenant with Abraham. Abraham at that time, of course, and he promises to give Abraham offspring. And as I'm reading through this, pay attention to the word count. It comes up a number of times here, and it's an important word. So reading then from Romans 4, Paul says, what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him as righteousness. Now to the one who works, his wages are not counted as a gift, but as his due. And to the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is counted as righteousness. Just as David also speaks of the blessing of the one to whom God counts his righteousness apart from works. And according to Psalm 32, he says, blessed are those whose lawless deeds are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man against whom the Lord will not count his sin. So in the story of Abraham, God counts Abraham as righteous on the basis of faith and not works. And Paul says that since justification is on the basis of faith and not of works, it's a gift from God. And finally, quoting from Psalm 32, Paul also ties justification not just with being declared righteous, but with the forgiveness of our sins when God does not count our sins against us. And it's important here, Abraham is not immediately made a righteous man. We read this in Genesis chapter 16, him and Sarai, and their dealings with Hagar. He was not made a perfect man, but he was counted as righteous before God. And then, but how can God then forgive our sin and count us as righteous? Well, Colossians 2:13, Paul says, you who were dead in your trespasses and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. So that's why, coming back to Romans, Paul in Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift, through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward as propitiation by his blood, to be received by faith. So again, trying to summarize this once more before I move on, justification is a gracious gift from God, which we receive when we place our faith, our trust, and our hope in Christ alone. And as Paul says in Romans 5:1, then, since we've been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. But, of course, that's not where the story ends. You know, in justification, God has judged us and gives us the verdict. We're forgiven. We're righteous in his sight. But there's still a problem here and now. I still sin. We still sin. Abraham still sinned. But things have shifted once we have believed. Paul says in Romans 7:22, I delight in the law of God, in my inner being, but in my members I see another law, waging war against the law of my mind, making me captive to the law of sin that dwells in my members. So there's still this tension, this war. And so when we believe and we're justified, we transition from being at peace with sin and war with God to now being at war with sin and at peace with God. And this is where we then transition to our second question about what is sanctification? Because sanctification, generally speaking, is just something being set apart as special or as holy. But when we're talking about it in the context of salvation, usually it's in speaking about the gradual process in this war against sin, as our gradual growing in righteousness. And there's many facets, again, of this that we talk about, but I want to just focus on two for the sake of time. First is that we don't wage this war alone. It's not that God saves us and then leaves us to our own devices. We wage this war by the help of the Holy Spirit. In 2 Corinthians 3:18, you read that, we all, with a veiled face, beholding the glory of the Lord, are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another, for this comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. So again, that's not something we do on our own strength, but we look to God, to the Holy Spirit, to strengthen us and help us in that war. And there's actually a really important phrase in there, too. Paul says we are being transformed, not that we have been transformed, we are being transformed. Which brings me to my second point about sanctification, which is that it will never be complete in the sight of heaven. There will always be that remaining sin with us. And in Philippians 3, Paul says, indeed, I count everything as loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ, Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I've suffered the loss of all things and count them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God that depends on faith. So he's looking to God to justify him. But he continues saying, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain to the resurrection of the dead. And this is an important phrase here. Not that I've already attained this or am already perfect, but I press on to make it my own because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Brothers, I do not consider that I've made it my own, but one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind, but straining toward the goal, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward calling of God in Christ Jesus. So at this point then, I invite you to join with me in reading the question. I invite you to stand. I'll read the question at the top and invite you to join with me in reading the answer. So what do justification and sanctification mean? Justification means our declared righteousness before God, made possible by Christ's death and resurrection for us. Sanctification means our gradual growing in righteousness made possible by the Spirit's work in us. Just take a moment in prayer. So Lord, I thank you again for your mercy and that you see us as a sinful people, unable to save ourselves. There is no number of works of the law we can do, for we are sinners and we will sin. Thank you God, that you sent your Son to be counted as sinful on our behalf, that he would suffer for our sins, and yet death could not hold him. He has conquered death. And now when we place our faith in him, you count us as forgiven and as righteous. And you who do not change your judgment upon us. Thank you for the confidence and the hope that we have in Christ. And I pray that you would give us encouragement daily, that you would help us to press on, to keep struggling forward for the upward call that you've given us in Christ. And especially this day as we gather to worship you through song, through the teaching and the preaching of your word, I pray you be active in our midst this day. This we pray in Jesus' name.